Hello, and welcome to the 2020 Mid-East Tennessee Home Education Association Commencement Exercises. My name is Randy Couch, and together with my wife Kelly, we are the area coordinators for Mid-East Theo. Due to the unfortunate circumstances surrounding the COVID-19 pandemic, I am very sorry to say that it is not possible to host our annual in-person graduation ceremony this year. And because of this, Mid-East Theo's board is deeply regretful. As it is, our church building that was set to accommodate our group is still not yet open to the public, and strict social distancing guidelines makes it extremely difficult to carry out a rehearsal, ceremony, and reception elsewhere for our graduates and guests. Therefore, please enjoy this pre-recorded ceremony that we have put together to honor and celebrate 8 very special high school graduates. Today is a day for rejoicing as it marks the end of their educational journey at home with family and the beginning of a brand new journey, one that is bright, hopeful, and full of anticipation. And so today, I would like to bring special attention to the Mid-East Theo graduation class of 2020.
Even as we are apart,
Let us join together to recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hello, my name is Clinton Kaus, a homeschool graduate and student at Cleveland State Community College, Athens campus. For our first commencement speaker, I am proud to introduce Mr. Robert Ellis, an American and World History instructor at Cleveland State Community College, who has graciously given his time to speak with us today. Mr. Ellis grew up in Petal, Mississippi, where he attended Jones County Junior College, William Carey University, and the University of Southern Mississippi, where he earned his master's degree in history. Currently, Mr. Ellis lives in Athens, Tennessee, and teaches history at Cleveland State Community College. I have been so grateful to study with Mr. Ellis now for over a year, gaining a wealth of valuable information under his tutelage, and in turn, he has become a mentor and friend. In his classroom, Mr. Ellis works to improve his students' understanding of the world and show them that through a thorough knowledge of history and world events, young lives are better suited to become effective leaders in the future. Mr. Ellis embodies a servant spirit in the mentorship of his college students, and therefore, I am very proud to share his remarks with you today. Please make welcome Mr. Robert Ellis.
Hello, everyone. My name is Professor Robert Ellis. I am a history instructor at Cleveland State Community College, where I've been for 7 years now. And I'm speaking to you, first of all, on behalf of a fantastic student that I have taught these last year or so that I plan to teach again in the coming year, Quentin Kaus. Quentin is a remarkable young man, and I've had the privilege of teaching him now. And he's a fellow homeschooler like you. And when Quentin first asked me about doing this, it really inspired me, and I really appreciated him thinking enough of me to ask me to do this. So I don't want to take up too much of your time, and this is not going to turn into a long lecture or anything like that, but I just want to say a few words to you for your commencement. And first of all, I just want to say congratulations. You have earned this in every possible way, and I know things are difficult right now, but to be honest, I graduated from a public high school in 1998, and I don't remember much of it, honestly. So you will always remember where you were in the spring of 2020, for better or worse. So I'm going to try to stick to the script on this. I've written some remarks, and as Quentin will tell you, I can get off the script pretty easy here. So I'm going to try not to get too carried away. First of all, I know I don't know any of you personally, but that doesn't mean that as an educator I don't care about you as a person or as a student. You've all earned this, and you will go on to continue to earn great things. I hope to see some of you in my classes in the future, and maybe this commencement talk or this speech or address or whatever you want to call it would be a good introduction. I've seen your video. I've seen your class photos and your home pictures, and it's remarkable, each of you as individuals. I'm gonna tell you something that you might not hear being said from other speakers. And that it's okay to be frustrated right now. It is okay to be upset. It is okay to be a little angry, honestly. I'm not going to sugarcoat things and paint a happy scenario of how great life is. But that's where you come in. I don't want you to use this anger and frustration right now to be negative. I want you to use it as a tool. I want you to use your frustration and your anger as a driving force. I want it to become an ember that slowly burns inside of each of you to go on and do great things in this world. Because the people that got us into this situation that we're in, you are the ones that are going to get us out of it one day. You're the ones that are going to say, this is not right, or we need to make this better, or we need to do this better. Because you went through this experience as a senior, as somebody who's entering the workforce, as somebody that's entering into the adult world. And this is a challenge that this country's not faced exactly like this and maybe forever. So it's going to be up to you. So I want to challenge you. I want you to use this experience. Use that passion. Use your frustration. Use your anger to make things right, to do things better than we did, to get us into this situation. Okay? So that's my first point. I'm not going to give you any inspirational quotes other than two, and they may seem like they're really from two very different opposing points, all right? These are the times that try men's souls, okay? The famous words of Thomas Paine on the eve of the American Revolution, okay? These are the times that are trying our souls, okay? We can do better. We will do better, okay? But I'm also going to throw another quote at you that seems to be the complete opposite of something like that, which goes back to my first point about it's okay to be angry, to be different, to use your frustration in a good way. And that's from Mike Tyson. And I know he's not somebody I look up to either. He's done a lot of bad things, but he has a quote that comes up often in these times, and I think about it, that everybody has a plan until you get punched in the mouth. And what we've just experienced is a great punch in the mouth. Okay? You've all been punched in the mouth. We've all been punched in the mouth. And I'll segue one boxer's quote into another boxer's from a fictitious boxer. I'm sure y'all know who Rocky Balboa is. And I know not all of the Rocky films are great, trust me. But Rocky Balboa said, it's not how hard you can hit, it's how hard you can get hit and keep going. And that is absolutely true. Don't let this stop you. Don't worry about the script. Don't worry about what the plans were. Don't worry about, I was going to do this or I was going to try to do that. Do what you can do, okay? If your plans change, then so be it. All of our plans have had to change. Honestly, as I sit here in my house recording this is the first time I've put on a shirt and tie in 2 months. I'm sad to say. But don't let yourself be afraid to think outside the box, to do things differently than other people have done. Because the status quo obviously hasn't worked to this point. What this crisis has revealed is everybody's focused on fixing the house of cards, okay? But we need to be focused on the table that the house of cards is sitting on. Okay, if the table's legs are not going to stand and they're crumbling or falling down, then it doesn't matter how well the house of cards is built or how stable it is or what you put under it to support it or everything like that. the foundation is the problem. So we weren't looking deep enough. And that's what you're going to have to do. You're going to have to go deeper than just the surface level of the situations that we're in. You're going to have to get to the fundamental roots, okay, of the problems and the things that are holding all of this up so that we don't get into a situation like this ever again. Okay? So I'm not necessarily trying to compare the entire world to a house of cards, but that's the situation that we're in. So again, I don't want to get dragged into the news and politics about what's what and what's going on and everything. I just wanted to speak to you. I just wanted to let you know that there are people out there that do care about you. There are people out there that are going to continue to help guide you. I know things are tough, and I know that your experiences at home are not necessarily the experiences that you're going to have out in other places and in other institutions of learning or in businesses. But I can tell you, if any of you on any level come out of this like Quentin or Blake or other homeschool students that I have taught this last year, we are in very good shape. We are going to be in good hands, because I have been teaching now for 15 years, and I have taught at middle school and public school and high school and college. And I am really impressed. I am increasingly impressed with the level and quality of homeschool students that are coming out and coming into my classroom. I see what y'all are capable of. I know what y'all can do. Y'all are as good, if not better, than every other student sitting in a classroom somewhere going through a private or a public high school. Okay? Don't let others' discouraging remarks, okay, affect you. Don't worry about what others say you can't do. Okay? You've got a new friend right here that has seen what you can do, and a new advocate. And I'm going to continue to support and advocate homeschooling programs. And again, I wanted to congratulate you all. I wanted to let you know that it's going to be okay, that you're going to fix things. It's not going to be fun. It's not going to be easy. And then it's okay. It is okay to be different. It is okay to be upset. But I want you to use that. I want you to use it and make a difference. So again, congratulations to a great group of students from the class of 2020. And I really wish you the best. And I look forward to hearing from some of you. Thank you.
Now, I would like to introduce to you Medes Thea's two outstanding students for 2020, Stephen Mitchell Phillips II and William Dean Yielding. Let me tell you a little bit about each graduate. Stephen Mitchell is an excellent example of what it means to be an outstanding student, serving in the community and in his church, helping and ministering in any way possible, portrays a Christian integrity and inspiration that Stephen has and gives to others. And in addition to graduating high school at 17 years old, including dual enrollment at Cleveland State Community College, while maintaining a 4.0 GPA, Stephen stays busy with volunteer service through his local church, community, school-based opportunities, and within the community at large. Born out of a strong desire to focus on ministry and volunteer outreach after college, some of Stephen's experiences include working at Game Changers Ministry and Hearts of Flame Ministry. His service work includes outreach programs that sink to nursing home patients one day per week, preparing and delivering food and gifts to the local community, including EMS, law enforcement, hospitals, and nursing homes, as well as helping to plan and implement community barbecues, Thanksgiving Day dinners, and family Christmas gift drives for those in need, as well as in school supply drives, among other community fundraisers and events. After obtaining a degree in ministry, Steve Mitchell is excited to continue to share his biblical knowledge, benefiting by his strong academic background, to better serve those around him in the community. We, with Manish Thea, believe that this makes her an outstanding student, and for sure. Congratulations, Thea. I am also very proud to introduce our next graduate to receive the Outstanding Student Award, William Dean Yeoman. Through his academic achievements over the school years and devoted service to family and church, all the while balancing working in his very own lawn service business and employment with a local company, William has proven that he knows what reaching goals through hard work really means. It is easy to say that he definitely embodies the American can-do spirit, being described by mentors, church leaders, and those who know him as best having a passion for assisting others. William is regarded as civic-minded and servant-hearted. It is said of him that he is compassionate and caring, always eager to help in the community where needed, and a positive source of encouragement to those around him, sharing the true love of Christ to young and old. This is especially true where children are concerned, in that he is an excellent role model to young ones, being patient, kind, and caring to his youngest friends. William Yeoman embodies the American dream, in which, after graduation, he knows that with his clearly laid out plan for achieving an education in automotive mechanics at Tennessee College of Applied Technologies Athens Center, as well as working toward an engineering degree to enhance his desire to own and operate an automotive customization and design business, the sky and his creative imagination are the limits to his aspirational goals. William Yeoman possesses a high sense of academic integrity, a godly role model, and quality character, and it is, for these reasons, a wonderful choice for Manish Thea's 2020 Outstanding Student Award.
The Senior Slide Show is one of the most anticipated moments of our commencement exercises each year. Please enjoy this brief glimpse into the lives of our graduates as they and their parents celebrate the journey.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no. Or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. Tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind. I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is while you're in the world. The moss, well, a few of the verses, well, they've got me quite cross. But the sun's been quite kind while I wrote this song. It's for people like you that keep it turned on. So excuse me for getting these things I do. You see, I've forgotten if they're green or they're blue. Anyway, the thing is, what I really mean, yours are the sweetest eyes of ever seen. And you can tell everybody this is the song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in the words how wonderful life is while you're in the world. I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in the words how wonderful life is while you're in the world.
Child. Whoa, 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 whoa.
It is my honor to introduce to you now our second commencement speakers, Mr. and Mrs. Ray and Charlene Knockgrass. Mr. Knockgrass is a Christian and veteran homeschooling dad who is also the president of the homeschooling publishing company, Knockgrass History. Mr. Knockgrass earned a bachelor's degree in history from Middle Tennessee State University, a master's in history from University of Kentucky, and a master's degree in New Testament from Harding University. Mr. Knockgrass enjoys reading and listening to classical literature and biographies, traveling, spending time with his children and their spouses, and admiring his grandchildren. He is deeply in love with his wife, Charlene, his wife of 46 years, whom he declares is the most wonderful person in the whole wide world. Mrs. Knockgrass is a Christian and a veteran homeschooling mother, having received a bachelor's degree in urban planning from Middle Tennessee State University. She now oversees curriculum development for at Knockgrass History and works as a lead curriculum author for the company. Mrs. Knockgrass loves to encourage other homeschooling moms, whether speaking at homeschooling conferences, counseling mothers individually, or as a source of inspiration through her blog, Daily Encouragement for Homeschooling Mothers. Ms. Knockgrass enjoys reading, quilting, drawing, sewing, continuing direction for improving their old house, and of course, most importantly, spending time with her husband Ray and their growing and loving family. Please welcome Mr. and Mrs. Ray and Charlene Knockgrass.
Board of Directors, parents, families, and friends.
And 2020 Mideast THEA graduates, William Bredwell, Emily Cox, Jonathan Deem, Max Murray, Jonathan Perkins, Stephen Phillips, Blaine Walker, and William Yielding. Congratulations, graduates of 2020, and congratulations, Stephen Phillips and William Yielding, for being Mideast THEA Outstanding Students for 2020. It is a joy for me to participate in this important moment in your lives. Parents, I'd like to begin by saying thank you to each of you. Thank you for homeschooling your children. Thank you for homeschooling these graduates. God has been watching you every day. He knows your unseen, faithful work day after day and year after year. Remember what Jesus said about faithful work that people don't see. In Matthew 6:3, he told us to give in secret. He said not to let our left hands know what our right hands are doing. Then in the beautiful language of the King James Bible, he said that we are to give in secret so that thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. Thank you for your faithful unseen giving to your children. Graduations are thrilling times in the lives of parents. Homeschooling parents get the biggest thrill of all. Well done, good and faithful parents. Graduates, I want to thank you too. Thank you for successfully completing all these years of study. And thank you for listening to your mother and father's teachings. Hold tight to their teachings. Solomon's words in Proverbs 6:20 and 21 give you just the advice you need on your graduation day. My son, observe the commandment of your father and do not forsake the teaching of your mother. Bind them continually on your heart. Tie them around your neck. Then Solomon tells you the benefits of your parents' teaching. He said, when you walk about, they will guide you. When you sleep, they will watch over you, and when you awake, they will talk to you. Don't let this wonderful gift of the teachings of your parents go to waste. You're getting ready to go into the world and make a difference. Live up to that challenge. Don't get discouraged. Ray and I recently saw a pretty but little bitty waterfall. It was just a trickle. But that trickle was trickling into a swift river. The trickle wasn't contributing very much in terms of volume, but it was still part of God's plan for that river. You are part of God's plan for the world. God is counting on you. He trusts you with the jobs he has for you to do. Remember what Paul wrote in Ephesians 2:10. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. As you go out into that world, Remember what Jesus said are the two most important commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Think about what you read, see, and hear about in the news. Imagine how the news would be different if everyone were loving God with all their hearts, souls, and minds, and loving their neighbors as themselves. Some of you may know exactly what you want to do tomorrow, and this fall, and for many years ahead. Some of you are probably quite unsure. Those who are unsure may be dreading the questions people tend to ask new graduates. Questions like, so now what are you going to do? Remember that you don't have to have everything all figured out right now. Ray and I were in our mid-40s when our family started Knotgrass History. It's okay if you don't know your entire life plan when you're 18 years old. Remember that every day is a gift. God doesn't give us yesterday, and he doesn't give us tomorrow yet. He does give us today. If you will live each one of your todays doing the will of God, you will have a successful life lived one day at a time. Get up every day believing, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Don't be afraid to try. How very sad to miss opportunities because we're afraid to try. I wonder what joys people miss because they decided that something is embarrassing or too much trouble or too scary to try. I grew up on a hymn that asked the question, when you left your room this morning, did you think to pray? It also has this admonition, don't forget to pray. I wonder how many blessings we miss because we don't ask God for them. Jesus promised, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. I would be heartbroken if I found out that one of our children or grandchildren needed something that I could provide, but that he or she had never asked me. Jesus assured us that we can ask. When a sadness or a problem comes into your life, do what Jesus told us to do. Ask. I want to encourage you to take care of your heart. The world has lots to offer you. Some of it is good, and some of it is evil. To take care of your heart, you're going to have to say no to some things and yes to some other things. We find a wonderful guide to what we should say yes to in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there's any excellence or if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. Go out there, graduate, and spend your lives thinking about and doing what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and respectable and excellent and worthy of praise. To do that, you're going to need to be very careful about how your husband or wife is chosen, as Ray talked about, and also how you choose your friends. Evil companions really do corrupt good morals. Be careful. Stay close to your family. One of the biggest blessings of being a homeschool graduate is that you're part of a homeschooling family. Stay close. Spend every day doing God's will. Jesus said that he came down from heaven not to do his own will, but to do the will of his Father who sent him. Jesus had a to-do list. His list had the most important task anyone on earth has ever done. Jesus knew what he came to earth to do, and he spent every day doing that faithfully. When I look at the life of Jesus as described in the Gospels, I see a man with a purpose, walking through life, often literally walking through life, meeting the needs of the moment, while keeping his ultimate to-do list constantly in mind. I believe that is exactly what he wants you and me to do. Always let God define how you should live your life. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Proverbs 3:5-6. When you read graduation cards at the grocery store, there are common themes. One of those themes is the future. The problem is that when most people think about the future, they don't think far enough into the future. They only think of college and careers and starting a family. They don't think about the really big future, our forever future. Love God. Trust Jesus. Love your neighbor as yourself. Live each day looking forward to the day that God will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant."
It's a great honor for Charlene and me to be a part of celebrating your graduation. We really appreciate the invitation. You are part of a history-making year. Congratulations on that. Although this is an honor you probably wish you could do without. The old saying about entering a world of uncertainties definitely applies to this year. But we must remember that God still holds the world in his hands, so we can trust him and be certain of the big picture, even when we can't see the specifics in the short run. Actually, we never can. But this year, all the uncertainties make it a bit more obvious. This is a special time for you. I remember my high school graduation 50 years ago, in June of 1970. Yes, it was 50 years ago, and yes, I remember it. You've accomplished something very special with your parents' help and the help of many others in your life. I hope that you will think about them right now and thank them profusely today and in the coming days. I believe you can accomplish much more in your life as God gives you the days and years to do so. I want to share with you some things I wish someone had shared with me at my high school graduation, or if they did, I wish that I'd been listening. These are things I've learned during the last 50 years that I believe will be helpful for you. I don't know that I can give you anything more valuable. Number one, stay connected with God, or get connected with him if you aren't already. My relationship with God through Jesus Christ has been my life and is my hope. I can't imagine trying to live without it. I encourage you to read your Bible and pray regularly. And I don't just mean go through the motions. I mean read hungry and pray needy. Let Bible study and prayer be an important part of the way you grow as a person. You are going to be in a battle for your heart, mind, and soul, whether you go to college or not. You will have influences pounding away at you to try to pull you in another direction. You are too valuable for those forces to leave you alone. Make it a fair fight by filling your mind with the right things and taking everything to God in prayer. I try to read a chapter a day and keep a prayer list. I don't make it every day, but I try to. Find a way that works for you and follow through. You have 15 to 30 minutes per day to do this. Number two, speaking of reading, I encourage you to read good books. Email me at ray@knotgrass.com and I'll suggest some. The motivational speaker Charlie Tremendous Jones said, 5 years from now, you will be the same person you are today, except for the books you read and the people you meet. I would add, and the trials you face, but his point is well taken. Your mind has too much potential for good to play out your life in a haphazard way. Have purpose in how you live and keep growing. Look at it this way. When you read, you won't have to take any quizzes or write any book reports. That makes it more fun right there. Number three, of the money you earn, give 10%, save 10%, and live on the rest with thanksgiving and praise. I heard that from Christian author Charlie Shedd many years ago, and lately I've been trying to do it. Life will be much better for you if you do. And don't spend that savings account too quickly or easily. Really live on the 80%. You'll be amazed at what you can do and how God will honor that. When you're working, and especially when you're part of your own family, you will be amazed at how fast your hard-earned money goes. But if you give 10%, save 10%, and live on the rest with thanksgiving and praise, you'll be able to help others and have some left for whatever God brings tomorrow. Number 4, pray about whom you should marry and be very particular about whom you marry. Pray constantly about whom you should marry and decide right now that you will marry someone who loves God more than that person loves you. Don't ever pressure someone of the opposite sex about anything. And don't settle for someone because you don't think you can do any better. You are worth the best that God brings into your life. So don't disappoint Him in this. The person you marry makes a huge difference in your life. That person can either help you soar and you can soar together, or that other person can drag you down and keep you from being and doing what you could. I am so thankful that Charlene and I share a like precious faith and have lived our lives close to each other, pretty much involved in the same activities, and we don't miss much of what is going on in each other's lives. I know I'm a better person because of her, and I thank God for her. Number 5, be humble. In Philippians 2, Paul says, consider others more important than yourself. In Luke 17, Jesus tells a parable which ends with him teaching, you ought to say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done that which we ought to have done. This doesn't mean be mealy-mouthed or a dish rag or a doormat. This means be at peace with who you are and who you aren't. If you are filled with yourself, there isn't room for other people. Enrich your life by putting Christ and other people and not yourself at the center of your life. Number 6, stay active in a healthy church. Doing this will be meaningful for what you get and for what you give. If I had not been involved in church, I would have missed knowing some of the most wonderful, godly, encouraging people who have been part of my life. And you get to serve. Just serve. Look for ways you can help others and encourage them. Learn their life stories. When you think you about have it together in your faith, go visit someone who served in Vietnam or who overcame a debilitating illness with faith or who cared for their aging parent or grandparent. Their faith and dedication and heart will likely put you in the shade, but they will give you models of what the Christian life is supposed to look like, so that you can live yours more powerfully. When church is done well, God is honored and you are blessed. Number 7, now this is a hard one. Don't break your parents' hearts. I think this is the bottom line message of Proverbs with its repeated admonitions to listen to your father's instruction and don't forsake your mother's teaching. They deserve your respect and your listening ear, even when you are 18, or 25, or 50. They have invested so much love and time and prayer and money in your life that they deserve your respect. When you look back 10 or 20 or 30 years from now, you will be glad you don't have the regrets that will come from rejecting them for whatever is popular or seems cool right now. They've gotten this far in life for a reason. Find out why and take hold of it. Respect their wisdom and experience. Don't just thank them for what they have done for you. Be grateful for what they have done for you, and say so frequently. There's a reason why one of the commandments is, honor your father and mother, that it may go well with you. Number 8, memorize and follow Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. If you do, He will. Don't even think about how it would go if you didn't. I've tried to talk to you about the most important thing in your life, the most essential part of your life, and that is living. Decide that you are going to live well, to live with a purpose, to live closer to God today than you did yesterday and closer tomorrow than you did today. I want you to have a successful life. And I believe what I've shared today will help you do that. I know I wish someone had spoken these things into my life and heart and mind 50 years ago and kept saying them, which is why it's a good thing that you can listen to this speech more than once, so you can see how much I've learned between the times you listen to it. I hope we can meet you someday. With all my heart, I say, God bless you. Thank you.
Graduates, your commencement ceremony is a celebration of accomplishment and time of reflection. You made it with a lot of personal hard work, with outstanding and dedicated mentors and cooperative teachers or tutors. As homeschool students, your primary and most dedicated teachers have been your own parents. Through your educational journey, you have been cared for, prayed over, and loved unconditionally by your family and closest friends. This is the point of our ceremony when we have the presentation of diplomas. This year, as I call the name of each candidate for graduation, their senior photo will appear on the screen. Your parents have already arranged for you to receive your high school diplomas at home, and each graduate's packet received in the mail will contain the Tennessee General Assembly High School Graduation Certificate, signed by Senator Mike Bell and Representative Mark Cochran from Hickman County and Representative Dan Howell for Polk County, in addition to your class of 2020 Mortar Board Test. Let's begin. William Cross Breadwell. Emily Marie Cox. Jonathan Dean. Maxwell Murray. Jonathan Hunter Perkins. Stephen Mitchell Phillips II. Blaine Alexander Walker. William Dean Yeoman.
Congratulations, Jonathan. The strength of your character, along with God's grace, has achieved great things in your life. Not only have you worked hard academically, but you've also held high standards in both servanthood and attitude. So proud of you. Love you, my son.
Congratulations, son. We are so proud of you. We know that you can accomplish anything you set your mind to. We love you.
Love you.
Now go conquer that dream.
Jonathan, we're very proud of you, and we love you very much.
You had to work hard in school and overcome many obstacles. We pray you will work hard and live well for God.